Hi, my name is Lewis.
I'm Brandon.
And this is Man Bites Film.
As always, we start every episode with a segment we call Love and Hate It. One of us picks something that we love, a film, a TV series, and we talk about it. And the other picks something that they absolutely hated or were indifferent about. So Lewis is going to start this segment this week with something that he hated.
Yep.
Yay.
I fucking hate it. Fantastic Four. 2015. It was just dragged on and on for the first about 3/4 of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
The last half an hour was decent. All right. IMDb gave this thing a horrible rating in itself. It gave it a 4.1.
Ooh.
All right. And then a 9% on Rotten Tomato. And that's well deserved because, I mean, Josh Tank did Chronicle. And this is what it felt like. It felt like Chronicle all over again.
I've actually never seen Chronicle. I've heard mixed things about Chronicle.
It was a good movie for what it is. But you can't make a superhero movie.
Yeah.
Like, especially Fantastic Four, the same thing as Chronicle.
Yeah.
I mean, Chronicle had, you know, it had the character establishment, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic Four had the character establishment and the origin story all over again. But then, at the end, the action sequence was just completely rushed. If the film was just the last half an hour of the film dragged on to a 2-hour segment of the last half hour, it would have been a fantastic film. And this would have been a lot better. I would have given it a lot higher rating. And the special effects were great. The character establishment was great. But it dragged on way too much doing the same character development.
Yeah.
They repeated themselves over and over and over again. I couldn't stomach watching it again. I really would not recommend going out to watch this in the theaters. But, I mean, if it comes out on streaming, then yeah.
I feel bad because I feel like I'm a comic book fan, so, and I feel bad for the Fantastic Four. They never get, they never get like just like a passing. Like the first two, which you've told me before, are better than the original one. The I think it's 2004 one. The one with Chris Evans and all those people. It's better.
It's comic booky.
Yeah.
It's gimmicky comic booky.
Yeah.
Which is what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be a fun summer movie. Was too serious.
Too serious. Took itself
for a summer movie.
Yeah.
You're talking about giving the darkness of X-Men for Fantastic Four, which is not the same. It's not the same franchise.
Actually,
you have to.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be fun. I mean, come on. The guy goes flame on. You know that's in the comic books.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like you can't take yourself serious if you're screaming out flame on. You know, it's a fun heart.
I felt bad. I was reading up on that movie, and the guy that plays Mr. Fantastic.
Yeah.
He said that they went to Comic-Con, and he was expecting people to come up to him and everyone, because you know they had just filmed the new Fantastic film. He said no one recognized him.
Yeah.
No one in Comic-Con recognized him or his fellow actors and actresses from being in Fantastic Four.
It's a very dark film, so you could barely recognize any of the characters, and you don't become familiar with the characters.
Mm-hmm.
They tell you, they spoon feed you what you're supposed to like about these characters, but you don't care enough to actually remember it. So by the end of the film, you're like, what was the film about? You're like, besides the action sequences and spoiler, Doctor Doom
of
sequence,
course.
That's the only thing that's actually good. This trailer was the best part of the whole film.
Yeah, I kept seeing the trailers and I was like, oh, please. I wish that they could get a break. They could catch a break, you know?
Yeah, no.
Actually have a good Fantastic Four movie, but no.
Maybe the next one is going to be a lot better.
Gets made.
It made enough money on the box office that pretty sure, yeah.
Okay.
It made enough money. It made its budget twice over. So that,
that
gives
bad.
It enough space. And
okay.
Marvel has more than enough money to throw into another.
Well, remember, this isn't Marvel. It is.
It's going to be part of the Marvel.
Dude, we could get so into this. I've read so much stuff. Actually, Marvel, to spite Fox, canceled the Fantastic Four comic book. Completely canceled it to spite Fox because, like, Fox is not willing to give up the rights, the film rights for Fantastic Four, so that Marvel can finally put them into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So they completely canceled everything that is comic book related to the Fantastic Four. So they're screwed. We'll see.
If the second one gets made and it's more like the last third of the film, then this is going to be a great film coming up.
Yeah.
Because he did a phenomenal job directing the action sequences and the real space odyssey that goes on in the last third of the movie.
The final act.
It was great.
Mm-hmm.
It was really good, and I really woke up because I was falling asleep. And the last half was good. It was good.
Yeah.
If it would have been shorter, it would have been great.
So hopefully Fantastic Four catches a break. I'm picking something that I liked. I watched it yesterday, and that is Red. On IMDb, it has a 7.1, and Rotten Tomatoes gave it a 72%. It's directed by Robert Schwentke. I can't read that guy's name. I'm sorry if I mispronounce that name. It's based on a DC comic book, which I'm not too familiar with, but I'm assuming it's just a band of, it's an espionage comic book about a ragtag group of, like, spies and stuff. I enjoyed it. I'd never seen it. I came into it thinking, oh, it's probably going to be a shitty movie or whatever. And I actually came out, like, I laughed. I was like, oh, this is pretty... It's lighthearted. The movie doesn't take itself seriously. Like, that scene when the car rolls over, he just, like, walks out with the gun. And he just, like, shoots as the car's, like, rolling behind him. It's just great. Bruce Willis stars in it as the main character, Frank Moses. He does a phenomenal job in his weird cadence that Bruce Willis has.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't act much. There's not much emotion going on in Bruce Willis's face.
He jumped out of character, out of his usual character for a while.
Yeah.
Which was really interesting because he normally doesn't get out of the oh, I'm a badass, I'm going to kick your ass.
I feel like he's stuck in that John McClane
thing
for the rest of his life, for the rest of his career.
I mean, come on.
You know?
It's like, it's Harrison Ford. You can't get out of freaking Han. I mean, he's always going to be Han.
Han or Indiana Jones. Those are his two.
That's it.
You know?
He's stuck in those two.
Yeah, he is.
He tried to get out of it and it just failed.
Yeah, I can't. But I liked his role. He did a great job. John Malkovich was great as...
always.
I forgot the character's name.
I don't remember. The paranoid guy.
Yeah, the paranoid guy that thinks that the whole world... That Big Brother's watching him and all that shit. He's great. Everyone was fantastic, and it was a really fun movie. Not too long. I never felt bored or... You know, I never felt like I wanted the movie to finish.
Yeah.
It was fun. There's a second one, which I've read is not that great, which... You know, what do you expect? Most sequels, either it's like a hit or miss. It's like it sucks or it doesn't. It's actually good. It's a good continuation to it.
I just gave up listening to what people think about movies, especially action movies. They go in expecting so much more than what it's supposed to be.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, action movies are supposed to be mindless, supposed to be the summer blockbuster, you know, fun. Not big on plot, just big on the action pieces and the explosions and all that shit.
Yeah.
But yeah, go watch Red. It was pretty good. I liked it.
For the first time in the history of the Cannes Film Festival, one film has swept all the major awards. Barton Fink.
Los Angeles, Mr. Fink.
Excuse me?
Howdy, neighbor.
Are you a writer, Mr. Fink?
Actually, I'm writing for the pictures now.
Oh, it's an exciting time, man.
Is that him? Is that Barton Fink?
Say whatever the hell you want. The writer is king here at Capitol Pictures. We're only interested in one thing. Can you tell a story, Bart? Can you make us laugh? Can you make us cry? Can you make us want to break out? Enjoy a song. Is that more than one thing? Okay.
Devil on a canvas, 12 apple, take one.
Having trouble getting started.
Wallace Beery, wrestling picture. What do you need, a roadmap?
We all need understanding, Barton.
Oh, you'll lick this picture business. Believe me, you got a head on your shoulders. And what is it they say? Where there's a head, there's hope.
I'm sitting in the audience. The lights go down. Capitol logo comes up. Come on.
Hank?
LAPD.
Got some questions we want to ask you.
Sorry, I'm in trouble. Something horrible's happened.
Female Caucasian, about 30 years old. Ever seen mud with anyone fits that description?
But, you know, with the head still on.
Well, Barton, you might say I saw peace of mind.
Oh. right now, the contents of your head are the property of Capital Pictures.
But Charlie, why me?
Because you don't listen!
I'm a writer.
A new film by Joel and Ethan Coen.
All right, now for our feature review, Barton Fink. This movie was phenomenal, mm-hmm. I think. I had seen this before, and I told you, you gotta watch this. This is one of my favorite Coen brother films, all right? IMDb gave it a 7.7 out of 10, and Rotten Tomato gave it a 91%.
That's pretty crazy.
And IMDb kind of dropped the ball on this one. I think it deserved a 9 out of 10, in my opinion. Just, the film has this dark, mm-hmm. very weird overtones to it. And you don't understand what's going on throughout the whole first half of the film.
I really didn't know. I was so, like, I knew what's going on, but I was like, there's not much going on. It's a weird movie, but...
Yeah. It's a very artsy movie.
Yeah, it's artsy.
I mean, from what I had read before the whole story came about, they were trying to write Miller's Crossing, mm-hmm. and they couldn't get past a certain point, a certain plot device that they were trying to come up with for the story. So they decided to actually write... another script.
Something else, yeah.
Because, you know, the Coen brothers, they, in their free time, they actually write more scripts. They don't do anything else. That's their life, is writing scripts and directing.
Yeah, they're talented. They're a talented set of brothers, so...
They wrote this script in 2 days.
That's crazy.
All right? The dialogue is so heavy in this film.
Yeah.
They must have literally just had a conversation, because the whole film is basically around two characters... John Goodman, which is phenomenal.
Yeah. And John Turturro. How do you say his name? I'm sorry.
The guy from Transformers. Yeah. The one with the balls that he starts screaming about the balls.
The guy, he plays as Barton Fink, basically. And John Goodman is his neighbor, Charlie. His eccentric neighbor.
Yeah. Which, spoilers from here on out, because we're going to be going in depth into it from here on out. So please watch this movie if you haven't already. Stop the video and rewatch it after you finish watching. I love the burning fire scene in the hallway. That was like so Kubrick-esque.
Yes.
I loved it. I love fucking Kubrick shots in films. I love their little homage to Kubrick. From The Shining, the long hallway shots. That was just phenomenal. I loved it.
I watched that scene, you know, and this is the probably you would consider what the final act of the film.
The final act of the film.
Yeah. And he comes out of everyone's complaining it's hot.
Yeah.
And like, you know, the detectives are complaining it's hot, and then you just start seeing this flame start coming out of the elevator. And then John Goodman just stared. Walks out, and it's super weird because, like, he starts running and every single, like, hotel room starts bursting in flames. And you're like, I was like, what is going on? Is he, like, supernatural? Or, like, I don't know. Like, it's super strange. Like, they never really tell you what the fuck is going on.
No.
They never really go into too much depth of who Charlie is or his alter ego, Carl Munt. Like... Did he kill Barton Fink's family? What the fuck is in that box that he gave him? It's super strange. They don't really go too much into detail about anything. It's a strange film.
I love Coen Brothers because they, at the end of their films, they make you think.
Yeah.
And if they don't make you think, they make you feel the emotion that they want you to feel by the end of the film. Hudsucker Proxy, at the end of the film, you just can't help but smile the rest of the day for some reason. It's the weirdest thing because there's... not real any clear comedy in the film, but you just feel like smiling for the rest of the day after watching it. It has this very lighthearted feel, and that's what this is. It's a very dark but lighthearted feel. The characters are all quick-talking New York style, you know, the old comic book style, like, hey, guys, I'm gonna kick your ass, you know?
No, it's the truth.
It's so cool, because you watch that, and you're like...
Yeah, as I was watching the movie, I was like, why are they talking so quickly? There's never any moments of pause during dialogue between any two characters. Even when it's relatively slow, which is usually between Barton and Charlie. Yeah. Those are the slow moments, but even then, it's quick paced. There's not many stops, and maybe it's like it's the whole they're going for the stereotypical LA thing that like life doesn't stop there. It's this quick paced lifestyle of like money and this and that and drugs and booze and whatever.
Yeah.
And it's interesting, like, the whole, I love the part, the hotel room, like, the constant fly and the wallpapers, which to me signified, like, his career just, like, coming apart.
Yeah.
Like, it slowly was, like, and he would, like, try to raise it up, put it back up, and his career was just, like, nope. I don't get the fly, though. The fly is, like, this nuisance to him, and
it's the buzzing sound of him basically selling out, because he's sold out. He's, like, you know what? I fucking need money.
Yeah. And he says it in the beginning. He's like, I'd never do that. I'll never do pictures.
And then he goes and does it.
And then he does it.
It's because at this point, you're talking about a starving artist. He doesn't have any money.
Yeah.
And in New York, that's not easy, dude.
No.
And in my opinion, that's not selling out, going to make a movie.
Well, really, was he starving, though? Because he was a playwright, and he was very well known in New York City for it.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You don't get paid. You get people giving you praises
and yeah, like standing ovations and shit like that. Yeah.
So it's I understand why he went to Hollywood and why that whole storyline developed, but honestly, I think it was all in his mind, the whole concept of what happened in LA. I think the whole thing was all his mind.
Yeah, you know, I had that like feeling. I was like, is this really happening?
I don't think so. I think it was all a split personality of him, cuz how coincidental that he finds his like admirer writer. And then on the other hand, you have the John Goodman
and character. His admirer writer turns to be the biggest douche on the face of this earth. He's an alcoholic and
then he finds out he didn't even write any of the favorites. So it's like, it's very internal conflict characters. So it makes you feel like maybe that's just him arguing with himself throughout the whole film.
It's a sad movie. Like, you know, he finally finishes the picture he's trying to write, which is a wrestling picture.
Yeah.
And, like, he shows it to the studio, and the studio's like, this is a piece of shit.
And we're going to keep you here to fuck you over.
Yeah, till you finish what we want, you have to stay here in L.A. and write something. And it's so sad because you could finally tell he poured his heart and soul into it. He wrote something that even he says is his masterpiece. And they don't even look at it that way.
I'm pretty sure that's Coen Brothers' little stab at Hollywood because they fucking hate Hollywood.
Yeah.
They've always hated Hollywood, and they never go by the norm of Hollywood standards for their scripts.
No.
None of them are cliche.
That's true.
Hollywood films. None of them. I mean, you have Hudsucker Proxy, you have Fargo, you have True Grit.
You've never seen it, Burn After Reading, which is really, it's a dark comedy, just like Barton Fink and Fargo and all that stuff.
And they love their dark comedies.
So, did Charlie kill the girl?
I don't think so. I think that's all internal conflict. That he was...
Okay. Because I found it strange. Like, how the fuck did Charlie just come into this guy's, you know, a hotel room and kill her? And, like, it looked like a gunshot wound. Like, she was bleeding a lot.
Yeah.
That Barton wouldn't find out that, you know, or wouldn't hear and wake up that and see Charlie standing over the bed with a pistol or a shotgun or whatever.
Yeah.
It's strange. It's... Like you said, like, it is, like, the whole film, I was like, is this really happening? Is this, that he's lucky enough, like you said, to find his the guy he looks up to, and then to find a guy that's right next to him, Charlie, who just befriends him, and it's just super strange, and then Chet is always there.
Yeah.
It's super weird. Like, and no one else works in that
hotel. Steve Buscemi. You only see three characters in the hotel. It's Steve Buscemi, which is a phenomenal character.
Yes, Chet,
he has such a weird personality in the whole thing. And then John Goodman. Those are the only two characters you really see. And Barton Fink.
Yeah.
That's it.
It's strange. There's not many characters in the movie.
Yeah.
There are, but like the main three are...
They're all pass-by characters.
Yeah, they're all pass-by. Like, they come here and there. But the main two are, of course, Barton and Charlie. And then sometimes Chet. But he doesn't really... interacts. But yeah, the movie was weird. Not in a bad way. I was just like, my brain was like, what the fuck is going on in this film the whole time?
After I first watched it, I think the closest comparison I had was Mulholland Drive.
Okay.
Didn't it give you that vibe? Yeah. Like, what?
Yeah, like,
what was
like,
that? But what? That was so cool, but what?
Yeah, like, the whole movie, you're like, what is going on? But then you're like, hmm... And super, like, and going back to the whole, like, is it really happening? And then at the movie ends with him finding a girl on the beach.
Yeah.
That is dressed exactly like this painting that he keeps looking at in his hotel room.
Yeah.
That gives him inspiration. Or
the postcard picture.
The postcard picture that gives him inspiration, or is just like his outlet.
Yeah.
And it ends with her doing the same exact pose that is on that postcard.
And which is interesting because the other thing, like, all right, most LA films, mm-hmm. they show you the beaches, they show you, you know, the very like touristy part of LA. This, they only show you the studio and the hotel.
That's true.
Throughout the whole film. So you don't even really know if he's in LA, technically. If you think about it, he's in his hotel room the whole time, and the characters in the what do you call it, the studio and everything, are so far out there. Maybe that's just part of his imagination.
His fear. His fear of what it would, how life would be if he would sell out and actually do, start writing pictures, as they call it.
So maybe this was him conflicting with himself, arguing with himself whether he should go and sell out.
He is a strange, timid guy in the whole film.
Yeah.
Like, he's really, like, he's jittery and, like, what the fuck is going on? And it's just weird.
He does complete opposite character of every other film I've seen in him.
Yeah.
The only other film I was, like, Transformers, which is, like, completely horrible character thing.
Yeah.
He literally looked like a child cartoon.
He's like a
Looney.
He's like he's just comical effect in Transformers. Like, he's a Looney Tune.
Yeah.
But not in this film. Like, he is.
He does a phenomenal.
No, I thought he did a great job in as Barton Fink. Like, I think him and Goodman, like,
out of the park.
They blew it out of the park, both of them. And Buscemi too, in the random instances that he's in the film. I love his bug eyes.
Yeah.
He's just like, I look at him like, you look like a lizard.
He'll always be like, crazy eyes, in my opinion.
Yeah,
that's crazy eyes. It's not Steve Buscemi anymore. That's my first instincts to call him that.
To me, it's always going to be Reservoir Dogs. I see Steve Buscemi
Mr. Pink.
Yeah, as Mr. Pink. And I won't say the line because it's super racist, but it's the best line in the film for someone. It just made me, when I hear it, like, I was like, Buscemi, I love you. I love you so much. But Barton Fink, I would watch it. I liked it. I would probably give it an 8. It's a little bit of a mind fuck, but watch and try to wrap your brain around it.
I'm more into the cinematography of it, the story writing, and I look into the aspect of the film, and I always put that into consideration when I'm watching a film, as fucking artsy fartsy as that sounds, and as, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
That's what I look at in a film.
See,
and I always put into consideration when I'm watching the film, which is stupid, but I just can't help it. That's the way
at it. I think Barton Fink is artsy-fartsy. Coen Brothers is artsy-fartsy twist. But it's not artsy-fartsy, as I like to call it, that you're up your own ass artsy-fartsy.
Yeah.
Because a lot of films are like that. They're literally like, poof, we fart artsy-fartsy, but then they're so far up their own ass that you're just watching, you're like, this isn't good.
Yeah.
This isn't good.
It's not David Lynch artsy-fartsy. It has the aspect of David Lynch's films, but it's something more commercially available to everyday person. It's not something that only a film student could actually look at and watch and like, okay, yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Appreciate.
I rated an 8 and go watch it. And what would you rate it?
I rated a 9. Solid 9. 9.
Solid 9. Do you know if this is on Netflix?
It is not on Netflix.
So we'll give you...
It's actually on Amazon. Streaming, which is good.
Prime?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you're a Prime member, we'll give you that link.
And if not, you could actually buy it. Walmart sells it for $5. Amazon sells it for $5. It's a cheap film to buy, so it's not even that bad.
Yeah.
So
you can find it anywhere. We'll give you that link, though.
Yeah. We'll see you guys next week.
See you next week.
This movie review.
As always, remember to like the video, comment down below, give us your thoughts on the film and any movies that you'd like for us to watch in the future. Remember to subscribe to our channel. And my movie for next week is going to be Snowpiercer.